Let's get rocking!
It's time for the Metal Groove.
We're fighters for truth, justice, and the American way.
A podcast dedicated to music.
Party on, dude!
Extreme close up!
Here's your metal host.
Well, hello, Mr. Fancy Pants.
Tombstone Josh.
I'm your Huckleberry.
What's up, everybody, and welcome in to an all-new episode of the Metal Groove Podcast. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. My name is Josh, and on today's show, we are going to be talking about the rock band Kiss, in one aspect at least. But they are one of the most legendary rock bands of all time. They're not legendary necessarily because of their playing style or lyrical content, in my opinion, but they do deserve some sort of credit for just writing these catchy, amphetic rock songs. I mean, influence alone, you know, based on their costumes. There's a lot of influence. I mean, there's a lot of people that love Kiss. They have a massive fan base. They were my first concert, so I got nothing but respect for Kiss. That you just probably wouldn't think of them as some of the most talented people as a group, as a whole, but they did write some amazing songs. So they are a legendary rock band in that aspect. And it's hard to deny that their foot stamp on rock music is not a massive leather dragon-shaped boot that shall be respected, man. So that's what we're going to be talking about today. We're going to be talking about some Kiss today. First things first, though, you are locked into the Thrill Me Podcast Network. Please make sure you hit that like and subscribe button. We have a mosh pit full of great content for you guys to check out and absorb and get in there and mix it up and have some fun with, as well as a Tee Public store with some awesome shirts on there. Speaking of content, I've been kicking around the idea of starting a new show that maybe can run intertwined with this show. Like I would do this one week and then the next week I would do this other thing. But another thing that stuck with me throughout my whole life since I was a kid, besides metal and rock music, has been Ninja Turtles. I'm a humongous fan of Ninja Turtles. I think I want to do a show talking about that. You know, whether it's the movies, the TV show, the comic books, that new book, The Last Ronin that came out, future projects to do with the Ninja Turtles. I just got a brand new Leonardo tattoo. I have a whole collection of just Leonardo Funko Pops and action figures to talk about. So that's an idea I'm kicking around. If you think it's a good idea, let me know. And, we'll see if we can go from there, man. So I appreciate you guys checking in, tuning in, and hearing me out talk about things I love, man. So appreciate you guys. All right, a few quick notes before diving back into the topic for today's show. There's some new music floating around there by the likes of Kitty, Def Leppard, Black Dahlia Murder, and Ghost. Make sure you give them all a listen and tell me what you think. Also, let me know if there's some new music out there you are checking out that I need to listen to, man. But real quick, my thoughts are, of the group I just mentioned, the new Black Dahlia Murder song, Aftermath, sounds brutal, man. And their guitar player moved over to do the vocals since their main man, their old vocalist, Trevor, had passed away, man. So it's good to see them back out there kicking out some new music, man. Like I said, this new song, Aftermath, it's brutal. It sounds good. Of all of the bands I'm talking about right now, this is probably my favorite song of the group. It's just more up my alley. It's a lot of fun, fast paced, good guitar work. So check it out, man. Also, Kitty's new song, Fire. It sounds all right. It's pretty standard Kitty stuff. Morgan Lander writes some great songs. And, it's just typical Kitty thing, man. And I enjoy it. It's a good thing. The new Def Leppard, Just Like 73, featuring Tom Morello. It's a miss for me, man. It just sounds like it's overproduced and it's weak and it's just kind of boring. And I mean, you kind of get the idea they're going for with this kind of like pump your fist, sing-along song. It's just a miss for me, man. It doesn't do anything for me. And then the new Ghost song. It's fun. You know what I dig about Ghost? Ever since I did the episode a while back about discovering them, because I never really listened to them before, and then I dove into their catalog, what's fun about this band and what I dig about them is that they are nothing like what you would expect. Looking at them from the outside, they look like a heavy metal band. They look like they're going to be hardcore. They look like they're going to be one thing. And then you turn on this brand new song, which is called The Future is a Foreign Land. It sounds like something you'd hear out of a Quentin Tarantino film, man. So it's interesting, man. It's really cool. It's a good song. It's fun. It's not one I'm going to want to listen to all the time, but I enjoy it. And yeah, so let me know what your guys' thoughts are on those bands, on those songs, on their releases. And we'll go from there, man. So good stuff, good stuff. But back to what we're talking about for today's show. For those that are new to the program, first off, welcome in. I hope you guys enjoy the show and you stick around. Don't give me too much crap. But I am a drummer. I play drums for a local band here in Charleston called the Nova Tones. We play every weekend. We're an awesome rock band. So if you feel the need, get out there, check out our Facebook page, give some likes. And if you're in town, come watch the show because we really put on a great show. Our singer is phenomenal and we have a good chemistry on stage. But anyways, that's a long way of getting around to the point of that I'm a drummer. I talk to drummers on the show occasionally, whether they're in national touring bands, whether they're local drummers that are just friends of mine. So I like talking drums. I like talking about, you know, kits and pedals and fundamentals and stuff like that. And sometimes I like to talk about bands that have multiple drummers and then I rank them. I did that before with Guns N' Roses and that kind of spurred the idea of doing this one today. And that's kind of what the topic is. We're going to talk about the three main drummers when you think of Kiss, talk about where they came from, what albums they played on. And then I'm going to do my best to give my ranking, of those guys. So, man, and then I'll wrap it up with, my top five Kiss songs as well. So strap in. Lock it down, and let's get started. I'll just go ahead and say right now, that song, 100,000 Years, is going to be an honorable mention on my favorite Kiss songs list. It's just killer between the guitar solo, drum solo, just everything about it. It's fun. Live, the song is just killer, man. It's awesome. Great, great tune, man. So honorable mention on my list that we will be getting into later. And here we go. We're going to dive into the topic of today's show. Who, in my opinion, is the best drummer for Kiss or was in Kiss now that they're retired. Gonna read a couple things. I'm gonna talk about them. And I know Kiss has a massive, massive fan base. There's tons of Kiss podcasts out there. There's experts when it comes to Kiss. Like I said, they're legendary. They're influential. They are a lot of things to everybody when it comes to rock music. The Kiss Army is a dedicated, hardcore bunch. Awesome fan base, man. And I wouldn't be surprised if I get some kickback for anything I say. So I'm just going to say up front, I'm going to get ahead of it. I like the band Kiss. Like I said earlier, they were my first concert. The first concert my dad ever took me and my brother to see was Kiss Psycho Circus Tour, 1999, 1998, somewhere around there. My brother and I had our face painted up. They have been a part of my life when it comes to music for as long as I can remember, man. So I like the band, I appreciate the band, but I am not as enthralled in the history of the band as some of you hardcore, dedicated Kiss fans are. So, take it easy on me if I say something dumb, if I say something stupid, or if I say something you don't agree with. I will gladly appreciate and accept any criticism that comes in my way for being wrong or missing stuff. So, again, this is just my opinion based on what I've heard with my ear and what I've watched from live concerts. And, you know, what I've gathered from listening to the songs, man. So, let's go ahead and start with the OG, Peter Criss. George Peter John Crisola, probably pronouncing that wrong, better known as his stage name. Peter Criss is a retired American musician, best known as co-founder, original drummer, and occasional vocalist of the hard rock band Kiss. Chris established the Catman character for his Kiss persona. In 2014, he was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame as a member of Kiss. After the demise of his band Lips, Chris placed an advertisement in the East Coast edition of Rolling Stone magazine, which read, "Experienced rock and roll drummer looking for an original group doing soft and hard music. Signed, Peter from Brooklyn." The advertisement was answered by Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons, who were looking for new members for their band. Simmons later in a chapter describes going on a small Italian club in Brooklyn to meet the drummer. The drummer started to sing, and this Wilson Pickett-style voice came out of him. Paul and I said, "That's it. That's our drummer." And, you know, the rest is history, man. Kiss released their self-titled debut in February 1974. Throughout the band's initial original lineup, Paul and Gene would sing the majority of the songs on each studio album, with Ace and Peter contributing on one or two songs. Chris collaborated on a demo called Beck, a song that was eventually reworked to become the ballad called Beth, a top 10 hit for Kiss. He departed Kiss. He's been back and forth. On the 1979 release of Dynasty, he played only on his own composition, Dirty Living. It did not play at all on the Unmasked album. Anton Figg, who also played on Ace Frehley's 1978 solo album, was hired as a session drummer for Dynasty and Unmasked. At the time, the reasons Chris was fired from Kiss were never made public, although it was obvious that his relationship with bandmates Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley was not good at the time. He went on to do his own solo career, which he had a little bit of success with. He returned to Kiss in 1995 on the official Kiss convention in Los Angeles that led to Kiss' live performance that was recorded for MTV's Unplugged in April of 1996. Kiss held a press conference to announce a reunion tour with all four original members. The 1996-1997 Alive Worldwide Tour was an enormous success, and the reunited Kiss released a studio album, Psycho Circus. Chris played drums on only one track on the album, Into the Void, Ace Frehley's one lead vocal track, although Chris did have one lead vocal, a track called I Finally Found My Way, written by guitarist, vocalist Paul Stanley and Bob Ezrin, and a co-vocal taking turns in the verses. Second and third departures, Chris left over a contract dispute and was replaced by Eric Singer in 2001. He rejoined the band in late 2002 and appeared on the Kiss Symphony Alive DVD and CD before departing from Kiss again in March 2004. The band had opted not to renew his contract following the Roximus Maximus tour. He was once again replaced by Singer, who assumed the Catman persona. He said of Kiss performing with replacements for Ace Frehley and himself, "No matter who they got to put stuff on their face, it ain't us. You can take the mask off the Lone Ranger and put it on someone else, but it ain't the Lone Ranger." After 2004, Chris kept his public appearances to a minimum. He now resides in New Jersey. He released a solo album in 2007 on Silver Cat Records. Chris performed his last solo show on June 17th, 2017 in New York at the Cutting Room. Okay. So, Peter Criss is the original. He has jazz roots. He is fundamentally one of the strongest when it comes to timing. He's not a standard rock drummer when it comes to, like, heavy hitting, fast groove type of stuff. But there's no denying his influence. There's no denying his creativity. There's no denying his stamp on music history. So, that's where we're going to stop right there with Peter Criss. I just wanted to give a brief background. His background is going to be a whole lot longer than the other two guys just because of his history with the band. So that's a little bit. Let's go ahead and move on to Eric Carr. The big hair. The big kit. The big sound. Rest in peace, Eric Carr. Man, he was a powerhouse, and he added just that double bass ferocity to the Kiss sound, man. So rest in peace. So glad to talk about him, man. He was a beast behind the drums. But next on the list, we're going to be talking about Eric Carr. Paul Charles Caravello, better known as Eric Carr, was an American musician. He was the drummer for the rock band Kiss from 1990 until his death in 1991. Caravello was selected as a new Kiss drummer after Peter Criss departed. He created the stage name Eric Carr and designed his own onstage persona called the Fox. He remained a member of KISS until his death from heart cancer in 1991. So let's talk a little bit about his time in KISS. During his audition, Caravello applied for KISS, submitting a cassette tape of KISS' current single, Shandy, but with his vocals over the music instead of Paul Stanley's vocals, and it sounded great, he enthused years later. The application was put into a bright orange folder to make it stand out visually. Jane Grodd, a KISS staffer, told him later that he noticed a brightly colored envelope and so picked it to be reviewed from the pile. While sitting outside the room he used for audition, Caravello watched all three members of KISS walk by and enter the room. He was one of the few people outside of the band's circle of friends, family, and music business partners to see KISS without makeup. Paul, I knew right away, he told a fanzine in 1990. The others I wasn't as sure about. Caravello was the last drummer auditioned for the band and asked Stanley, Simmons, and Frehley to autograph the list of KISS songs he was there to play with the band in case he never saw them again. But I had knew it, Stanley said in that same interview. According to Caravello, his audition was videotaped. He was also immediately comfortable, feeling the songs he had to play were a snap. He knew in the arrangements better than the band did from learning the recorded versions of KISS albums. They had been on tour and changed little things around, he said. He was not impressed with KISS's performance at the audition. They were awful, he emphasized. I had to remind them, no, I sing this harmony, you sing that one, stuff like that. It was great. Right away, we were working together, and I know it impressed them. Stanley later described Caravello's audition. He was the guy who cleaned stoves for a living, and the first thing he said to us was, it's a real pleasure to meet you, let's play. And we started playing, and it was like thunder. And even though he was the shortest guy in the room, it just fit like a glove. The one thing that probably sealed it for us was when the audition, he asked for us autographs. It wasn't brown nosing, it was just him being a real person. A significant advantage for Caravello may have been his relative anonymity, as it was important for the band to maintain its mystique surrounding members, said Paul Stanley. It was really important for us that we got somebody who was unknown. We didn't want somebody who was last week in Rod Stewart's band or in Rainbow. Before they issued a press release announcing the addition of Caravello into KISS, they subtracted 3 years from his actual age, in part to confuse those seeking information about his true identity, but also to help create an identification with Caravello, a young fan chosen from the crowd to be the new KISS drummer. After Caravello passed the audition, time was short and the band had some trouble coming up with a character persona for his stage name before his debut concert. We never actually told him he was in the band, stated Paul Stanley in 1983. We just said, in 2 weeks we're playing. Paul Stanley alleged that Caravello wanted to use the stage name Rusty Blade until Stanley dissuaded him. Caravello decided on Eric Carr quite carefully. He noticed that while the four members' full stage names were three syllables long, Chris' name was the inverse of the other three band members' name syllable pattern. Peter Chris was also two syllables followed by a single syllable. He decided to make his stage name sound the same rhythmically as Peter Chris by choosing a double-syllable first name and a single-syllable last name so that when people said all four names together, it would still fit to the same ear. Carr was shortened from his birth name, Caravello, and he chose Eric from a list of first names his girlfriend at the time had created. Paul Caravello remained his legal name. For his KISS persona, Carl initially tried the Hawk. This concept was apparently very difficult to recognize in grease paint, but suitable makeup design was never created, and the Hawk costume was a bright orange yellow. The idea was dropped after Paul Stanley mentioned it looked like a Big Bird. With the band on deadline, only 2 weeks before Carr's stage debut, Carr came up with a makeup design for the persona of the Fox. Simmons liked it, and thus the character was born. The original design was modified within days of Carr's initial photo sessions and debut concert as a KISS member. Carr's first public performance was with the band in New York City's Palladium on July 25, 1980. His parents warned not to tell anyone their son was in KISS. They attended the concerts and were recognized by a friend who worked with Carr at a repair shop and had no idea the new KISS member behind the kit was his former co-worker. That's pretty cool, man. His persona remained consistent for 3 years until the band's well-publicized removal of their stage makeup in September of 1983 live on MTV. The drastic move came after declining album sales and poorly attended U.S. tour. Carr thought the band was coming to an end, but Kiss slowly turned their career descent into a rebound, and the band thrived once again. Carr earned a reputation amongst fans for being very friendly and approachable. He answered more mail than other band members and often added messages to his autographs. Despite replacing an original member, he gained popularity amongst fans based on his personality and percussion skills. All right, his tenure in Kiss. On August 29th, 1980, Kiss began the European tour in support of the Unmasked album. This was Carr's introduction to playing to large audiences, such as 30,000 fans in Milan. Carr's first album with Kiss was 1981's The Elder, which marked a departure for the band towards a mystical art rock direction. One of Carr's contributions to the album, Under the Rose, is one of the few Kiss songs written in 6/8 time and featured in a Gregorian chant-style chorus. Carr also co-wrote Escape from the Island with Freely and produced by Bob Ezrin. It was the only second instrumental recorded by Kiss. Poor album sales and lower chart position did not allow Kiss to tour in support of The Elder. During the summer of 1982, Kiss dedicated themselves to creating hard rock albums that predominantly featured Carr's drumming and his unique style. Creatures of the Night was released in October 1982. The heavy reverb on Carr's drums was a unique sound not previously heard on Kiss albums. The album featured 9 songs, none of which were written by Carr. In late December 1982, Kiss began their first tour in North America since the 1979 Dynasty Tour. It was Carr's first North American tour. The tour was poorly attended, unfortunately. In June, Kiss played in Brazil for the first time in front of approximately 137,000 people. Golly, that's a big crowd. Carr received writing credits on All Hell's Breaking Loose, from Lick It Up, Under the Gun, from Animalize, and No 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 from Crazy Nights. Carr said he found writing lyrics harder than writing music. Besides drumming, Carr also played guitar, bass guitar, and piano. He also sang background vocals. Occasionally he sang lead vocals, such as on Black Diamond, Young and Wasted. His first lead vocal in the studio was re-recording of Beth. Well, that's interesting. A song originally sung by Peter Criss for the 1988 compilation album Smashes, Thrashes, and Hits. Carr recorded his version of the song in the same room in the record plant where the song was originally recorded, using the same backing track as Criss. In 1989, he recorded a demo with Kiss lead guitarist Bruce Kulick. Carr wrote the music, played bass and drums, while Kulick played guitar. As Carr was not a proficient lyricist, he presented the demo to Simmons, and the words to Marvin Gaye's 1965 hit, Ain't That Peculiar. Simmons wrote new lyrics, which Carr recorded for a subsequent Hot in the Shade release. As a replacement member, Carr was a paid employee and did not have voting privileges, unlike the 4 founding members who shared profits and voting rights equally. Though Carr's years and Criss, his rank as an employee was a source of significant discontent for him, he felt excluded and unfairly treated as a second-class Kiss citizen. Unlike fellow band member Bruce Kulick, with the same status, Carr grew ever more frustrated and unhappy, culminating in his feeling ditched by Kiss during a 1991 hospitalization. In his autobiography, Peter Criss listed Carr as one of the people that Simmons and Stanley drove mad. Carr was reduced to sitting in his hotel room with all blinds drawn, drinking and refusing to come out. However, this account is questionable, as Carr and Criss only met a few times during the 11-year Carr was with Kiss. The two drummers were on friendly terms, but did regularly contact each other and were not friends. Carr's last recording with Kiss was for the song God Gave Rock and Roll to You, which featured him on backing vocals. Last time Carr worked with Kiss was in July 1991, when Kiss filmed the video for God Gave Rock and Roll to You, with Carr playing drums. Carr's last public appearance with the band was MTV Video Music Awards in September of 1991. It's a tragic ending to what was a raucous, heavy, awesome kind of, like, I don't know if rags to riches is the right story, but for what, like they said, him coming from cleaning stoves to being a drummer for one of the biggest rock bands in the world, man. And for his talents, and like I said, sadly missed, rest in peace, Eric Carr. Kind of stinks the way that his tenure ended with them, but I guess that's what fate was, man. That's what was in the cards, man. So rest in peace, Eric Carr. Great legacy. I'm glad he had his own persona. And, yeah, man. All right, let's move on to Eric Singer. Eric Singer, the third and final drummer that I'm going to be talking about for this particular conversation, this particular show, talking about drummers of Kiss. We're going to talk about the last drummer that played with them, the one that did the final reunion tour or the farewell tour, whatever you want to call it. Eric Singer, born Eric Doyle Messenger, is an American drummer associated with the hard rock band Kiss on and off from 1991 until the band's retirement in 2023. He has also performed with artists such as Black Sabbath, Alice Cooper, Lita Ford, Badlands, Brian May, and Gary Moore, as well as his own band ESP. In his career, Singer has appeared on over 75 albums and has 11 EPs. All right, let's talk about his time with Kiss. In December 1991, Singer officially became the drummer of Kiss after the death of Eric Carr. Singer, who had performed with Paul Stanley on his club tour along with Bob Kulick 2 years earlier, was hired and debuted with the band on the album Revenge, which I think is a pretty cool album. You know, not the best work from Kiss song-wise, but just Eric Singer's drum work's pretty cool. It's pretty interesting. On which he was originally slated to fill in some tracks while Eric Carr recuperated from heart cancer. Singer played on Carnival of Sores, the final sessions, and toured with Kiss until 1996 when the band reunited with original drummer Peter Criss for the Alive Worldwide Tour. After 5 relatively quiet years, during which Singer toured with Queen guitarist Brian May, Singer was asked to rejoin Kiss in 2001 after Criss's departure shortly before the Australian and Japanese leg of the Kiss Farewell Tour, one of the farewell tours. Singer debuted in full Catman makeup and costume for the first time on tour, which caused some controversy as the persona had previously been only used by Peter Criss. Singer was replaced again by Criss late in 2002, but returned to the band in early 2004 after Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley opted not to renew Criss's contract. Since then, Singer has been playing drums in Kiss as their permanent drummer. In 2009, Singer, along with lead guitarist Tommy Thayer, played and sang on Kiss album Sonic Boom, the first studio album to feature the new lineup, included the track All for the Glory, written by Stanley and Simmons, with vocals by Singer. In October 2012, Kiss released their 20th studio album, Monster, which includes a track called All for the Love of Rock and Roll, sung by Singer, written by Stanley. In a 2008 interview, Peter Criss stated that he thought Singer was a great drummer despite being upset about Singer's use of the Catman costume. All right, so while seemingly it seems like he had been with them for the longest amount of time, there's not as much info, backstory, or anything to go along with Eric Singer because he's pretty much just been a Catman fill-in on and off for Peter Criss since 1991. So while there's not as much back history with him as far as Kiss goes, as you heard when I said at the opening part of this, the dude has a massive collection of songs. He's worked with so many people. And this one to me is going to be a lot harder when it comes to deciding who is the best Kiss drummer. Because I mean, it's not like when I did the Guns N' Roses one where you had Steven Adler, who was the original, who put the actual heartbeat into the album, Appetite for Destruction, and then Frank Farr, who has been with Guns N' Roses the longest tenured. It's not going to be like that, because in that episode, I picked Matt Sorum as the creme de la creme, the best drummer, because what he can do technically. Technically speaking, Matt Sorum is the best drummer, in my opinion. He is a human metronome when it comes to that. And it's kind of funny that I bring that up now because I was reading Matt Sorum's book, and one of the clear-cut reasons why he wanted to be a drummer, why he decided to go on and pursue that as a career, was actually a Kiss concert. He went to see Kiss in concert. While he said he enjoyed the show and he enjoyed the theatrics and the songs, he looked at what Peter Criss was doing on drums and he said, I can do that. And I could do that a whole lot better than him. And that kind of is what kickstarted him on his tour and his career and his lifespan of playing drums, man. So Matt Sorum, one of my favorite drummers of all time. And that's who I picked in that episode of Best Guns N' Roses Drummer. This one to me is going to be a little bit tougher. So let's kind of dive in a little bit into what each one brought to the table. All right. So here we go. Best is a loaded term. Very subjective. From a purely technical standpoint, Eric Singer might be the most impressive, clean, technical drummer. He also, though, might be the most forgettable drummer of the three. If you just listen to his 100,000 Years solo, in my opinion, it crushes Peter's version of that solo. But in the songs, Singer was playing a character. I mean, he's playing these iconic songs almost exactly as recorded. Not room for much improv or self-expression. Eric Carr was also very skilled, but he was memorable and he was interesting and incredibly technical, especially when compared to what Peter Criss was doing. When it comes to soloing, for example, if you go back and you listen to the solo before War Machine or after God of Thunder, they just resonate. His fills, his double bass work, tenacious but smooth. What Carr brought to the classic songs, plus what he added to the new stuff, it just made an impact, especially with me. It wasn't so cookie cutter like what Eric Singer was doing with the classic songs. Now, on the flip side to that, sometimes Eric Carr's energy rushed the songs, so his timing and his control kind of lacked that expertise that Eric Singer has. Peter Criss might be the most musically unique of them all, though. Kiss's music was unique and easily identifiable, probably because of what everyone hears first, and that is those drum patterns and that swinging groove that Peter Criss brought that gave Kiss. Musically, it was very simple, not progressive, but Peter Criss added, with his jazz background, just his signature fills that gave the songs its magic. That's kind of what I'm getting to. In my opinion, he just added that magic. Peter Criss is what made Kiss what it was, again, in my opinion. While Eric Carr had great chops and a huge sound, Peter added an undeniable groove that Kiss quite hasn't replicated by anybody else. I mean, Eric Singer might be the perfect combination of the two. You have the power and the huge sound from Eric Carr, and you have the chops and the feel and the groove of Peter Criss, and Eric Singer just kind of like met in the middle somewhere. I mean, obviously, Peter was instrumental on who Kiss was and what their sound was, but he didn't play the songs the best, especially in the later years. Like, if you just go back and look at the 90s stuff and the reunion stuff, like, for me, I always thought Peter Criss was like a 60-year-old man, no matter what year it was. He just kind of, like, there was just something about his playing, while impressive and good, it just kind of lacked something. This one has been truly tough to decipher for me. I mean, going back and listening to these songs, watching concerts, watching solos. I mean, I'm just trying, and not trying to let that Peter Criss as an original member bias interfere with any of my decision making, man. This one almost feels like a 1A, 2A, 3A situation. But we all know everyone can't get a trophy, man. So here are my rankings. Again, these are subjective. Like anything based in music, this is just my taste. This is just my opinion. So here we go. Without further ado, and as much as it pains me, I'm going to have to put Peter Criss at number 3, man. While I appreciate what he did for Kiss, there's just a lack of energy that I particularly look for in drumming, man. There's a beauty in his laid-back approach, but in terms of skill, I think he is not as strong as the other two. Coming in at number 2 is going to be Eric Singer, man. Spectacular drummer, great chops, and pardon the pun, a master of the copycat. Whether it's what he was told to do or not, his just creativity is what's going to put him at 2nd for me. But still, a great drummer, man. Awesome drummer. I remember way back in the day, I bought a Pearl drum set, and it came with this Eric Carr drum tutorial video. And I remember watching that and just, you know, picking up some things, learning about how he set up, learning about how the way he played. And it's awesome, man. Just and nothing really, like, as much of a great drummer he is, nothing really particularly stands out compared to the next guy who's going to be at number 1, man. And I have at that top spot as the number 1 drummer of Kiss, in my opinion, it's got to go to Eric Carr. It's like those debates when people talk about who's the best drummer of all time. Normally in the top 2, people are debating Neil Peart and John Bonham. And I normally lean John Bonham because of the power, because of the drive and because of that energy, my gosh, I could not do what Neil Peart does. Phenomenal, incredible drummer. But if you're asking me who I want to watch, who I want to listen to, I'm going to want to listen to Led Zeppelin over Rush. That's just my opinion. And Eric Carr was that for Kiss. To be somebody that took those iconic songs and just added some ass to it. He added that oomph to those songs, man. And, you know, if you match solo to solo, the Fox to me was just more fun to watch, man. So Eric Carr, number one drummer, in my opinion, for the band Kiss. So let me know in the comments if you agree, if you disagree. I'm open to all conversation, all debate. Please bring it on. So yeah, that is my ranking of the Kiss drummers right there. Real quick, I know this one is drug on, man. I wanted to share my top five Kiss songs. Also, feel free to share yours and any of your thoughts about anything I've talked about today. Please throw them in those comments. Please like and subscribe. Please share. I'm trying to grow this little show I have going on right now. But here are, wrapping up this week's show, here are my top five Kiss songs. Not best songs, just my top five favorite songs. And we're going to go with number five, God of Thunder. Coming in at number four, we got Deuce. At number three, I've Had Enough, which is the album opener for the album Animalize. Coming in at number two is one like I talked about earlier. It's got a near and dear spot to my heart. It's the first concert my dad ever took me to. It was a Psycho Circus tour. So coming in at number two is going to be the song Psycho Circus. I just dig the song, and it has a cool little special memory for me. And then coming in at number one, the one I love to play the most, the one I like to listen to the most, that is Detroit Rock City. Yes, that is my top five Kiss songs. And I know you're saying, hey, man, he picked 80% Peter Criss songs as his favorite songs. Like I said, the songs from the Peter Criss era are better songs. The playing Eric Carr's generation is just better, in my opinion. Again, this is all subjective. But that is my top five Kiss songs. That is my top three rankings for Kiss drummers. I hope you guys enjoyed this episode. I hope you guys agree. But if you don't, let me know in those comments. Like I said earlier, please like and subscribe. Check out everything we have going on here at the Thrill Me Podcast Network. And we will be back soon. I'm going to be talking to a local band in the Charleston area. They are awesome, man. They are one of the hardest working bands in Charleston. Looking forward to talking to them. But stay tuned. Keep your eyes peeled. Stay safe. Stay healthy. Most important, stay metal. We'll see you guys next week. Hey, that's the show for this week. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Please make sure you hit that like and subscribe button. And join us here at the Thrill Me Podcast Network, where you can check out phenomenal shows like Haunters Podcast, The Review at Rob Show, The Mr. Wonderful Show, and Core Memory Unlocked. We greatly appreciate you, and until next time, stay metal.